Strange now to think of you, gone without corsets and eyes. Strange now to think of you, strange now to think of you, strange gone now without corsets and eyes.
I know jazz has been a real center point of you of your work the last years, but in the earlier
It was always. I mean, I grew up playing classical music because my mother played classical piano, but my father played in big bands and played saxophone, and he didn't really listen. You know, it wasn't the jazz that I listened to, but it was sort of, it was kind of more mainstream stuff around. Yeah. But I would say when I was a kid, I was more affected by classical music in a way, and sort of the attitude of big band music. But when by the time I was 14, I was playing clarinet. And I was so nervous at auditions. And I didn't get into this one school that I should have gotten into it because I couldn't even barely play. I stopped playing entirely. But before that, all I did was like play basketball and play clarinet. Mm-hmm. Then all I stopped entirely in high school. Stopped, and all I did was read. And all of a sudden I became it was like it was the craziest thing. And I didn't start playing saxophone. Yeah, I didn't until I was like 18. When I went to Columbia, I went to college, and my friend, my cousin, gave me some acid, and I sat in a tree, and we listened to Coltrane. He played me my favorite things, and I said, "That's what I want to do in my life." It was as simple as that. That moment, and I just said, "This is
why I play soprano."
And I couldn't get a soprano because everybody. Then I started playing alto, and I started taking lessons. And and since I had played so much clarinet, that's the great thing to have if you have a kid. That's why my kid, I make him practice because I make him practice because I think like if you're playing when you're a kid, you can say whatever you want, but music is a hard language. And if you don't start when you're a kid, it's so much easier when you can play because you could quit when you're in high school or something like I did. But if you have it and you come back 4 years later, if you're starting all over when you're 18, 19 years old, it's hard. It's just like learning a language. It is just like learning a language. So then I practiced all the time. I dropped out of school. And I always just wanted to play, and I listened to different kinds of jazz. But I heard the first band that I heard live was Ornette at Slugs with Bill Dewey Redman and Charlie Hayden at Blackwell. And it was the greatest fucking band. I heard that and I just thought, after the Coltrane, that was that same song. And I just said, forget about it.
I mean, it's enormous.
This is unbelievable. This is a world's lifetime's worth of shit to know. And I was right. When I first came to Germany, it was 1984, 1983 with the Lounge Lizards. And being a Jewish kid from Brooklyn, I grew up in Flatbush, which is where I live now. It's kind of a working middle class neighborhood, and Warsaw wasn't the suburbs, it wasn't. And we had more people from the Holocaust there than anywhere, but it was such a lefty neighborhood. We had like my best friend's mom was an organizer for the teachers union, was put in jail during the McCarthy stuff. So it was really the tradition of Jewish communists and Jewish socialists.
Yeah.
That's what it was. We were thinking about, going to Germany. In America, you see all those, like these comedies about the Germans and the war and all this kind of stuff, and Achtung, blah, blah, blah. And, the first time we were playing in Berlin and we were in the train and these German guards woke us up and went, Achtung, give me your red. I was like a Nazi. But the truth is, that if it wasn't for the German, this is the ironies of life, wasn't for the great way that the German education system, had people know something about art, unlike America where they don't know a fucking thing about anything. People kept paying for the Lounge Lizards, they kept bringing us there. People know that my whole history of playing, and outside New York, people know nothing about me, nothing. And, you know, I'm not saying that they should know everybody about any of this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, you talk about novelists, they've never read a book. Mm-hmm. It's the most illiterate country. It's impossible. Yeah. It's impossibly illiterate.
It's intellectual poverty.
Intellectual poverty, has no education. It's horrible. And first time somebody told me when I was there, I said, this is amazing. Like, mm-hmm. people would like know who, you know, Harry Parch was, yeah. Mingus, and, you know, I mean, it was like nothing. That was like, yes, that sounds a little bit like when Mingus was, like, what?
How do you know that?
How do you know that, you know? It was crazy.
Because we read some damn books.
Yeah.
And we got some material.
Open the book.
Yeah.
And you know, and I said, now, why is this? And somebody told me that they spent, this was in 1984, I know, after the wall came down, it's a little different, but five times as much money on theater in Germany alone as in America we spent for all the arts combined. And that's what's really crazy. And like, then you have something in America, and the irony, of course, about America is that then you have these pockets of incredible richness, like the 50s jazz scene. Yeah. I mean, these people were brilliant. Bird and all those people and stuff, and they all read crazy stuff. Like Monk, I mean, these people, you know, these were like, Mingus, these were incredible intellectuals.
Like Sun Ra and all these guys.
Yeah, they knew they were talking about ideas.
Yeah, yeah,
they knew they were in the business of ideas. Oh, so, I mean, Dolphy, unbelievable.
You mean, you ain't fooling me kind of thing. That's what
they
were saying.
And as a result, they looked like Martians.
Yeah.
They looked like Martians to majority of white America and to a good amount of black America.
You know, when people hang out together and they work together for a while, they do grow to care about each other, and that caring is the kind of gravity that holds us down on this earth. And then, of course, we drift apart. And that has that kind of love, some kind of pain to it. So I'm over here today just to tell you the truth.